His is one of the saddest tales of lost potential and early death in the history of the violin. I'm the classical nerd, and today we're talking about Josef Hassid. Josef Hassid was born in December 1923 into a family of Polish Jews, and he had three siblings. His father managed his early musical career, which he started in earnest at the age of 10, the same year his mother died of typhus. Within 1 year, he was already competing and placing in competitions, hopping from teacher to teacher, helped along by the management skills of his father. One of these was Karl Flesch, a great Hungarian violinist, and although Hassid would never be his favorite pupil, he was considered a unique talent. According to Flesch's writings, Fritz Kreisler, the great Austrian violinist, said that Hassid was a once-in-200-years sort of talent. Flesch's teaching seemed to help him along, as his style did not really emphasize the technical facility, which he already had in spades. Rather, it focused on the ability of a player to really interpret the music and make it sing, make it fly off the page. Accompanists and audiences alike were flabbergasted at the boy's technical facility, his remarkable depth of understanding, and the magical and otherworldly air that seemed to accompany him whenever he put bow to string. His tour of England, in particular, served as his coming out party. The only problem was something that seemed to have plagued him since his earliest days and his earliest competitions. He suffered from memory lapses. As time went on, critics, once enamored of him, began to see cracks in the armor. And in addition to his memory lapses, things like instability of tempo and line were mentioned. And if he'd been like that in his early days, he would never have gotten to the position that he found himself in. By 1941, he was clearly suffering from a severe mental disorder, the likes of which turned him into a raging and violent person, the opposite of who he usually was. By June of the same year, he was diagnosed with schizophrenia and hospitalized. And his father and his managers and his teacher all said that it was very, very important that they do whatever they could to cure him. They did not want to lose that once-in-200-years talent. He was put into a medically induced coma and underwent shock therapy, both of which probably didn't do anything to help him. If anything, they made his issues worse. By the end of the year, he was committed to an insane asylum, where he never regained normal function. After his father died, they decided to operate on him, and he underwent a lobotomy in October of 1950. This got infected, and he died early the following month, at the age of 26. In that era, around 30 patients a year died from the complications of such a procedure in British hospitals. Some stories, which don't altogether seem credible, recount a forced breakup between Hassid and a British girl whose parents did not like the idea of her marrying a Jew. But this does not really have all that much evidence to back it up, and it seems like a fictionalization of the root cause of his mental illness, an attempt to understand what is not understandable. Sometimes these things just happen, and we as humanity would rather like to think that he was driven to being crazy because of some kind of lost love, when in reality it was something that was beyond his or anyone else's control. A better explanation with more evidence to back it up is the memory lapses. They continued throughout his career. There's something that plagued him, got worse, and then was a manifestation of his mental illness when he was institutionalized. Whether he really had schizophrenia or some kind of other disorder, we don't know. What we do know is that whatever plagued him mentally just eventually grew and got the better of him. Surviving recordings of Hassid, all of 8 small encore pieces, show off a tremendously captivating and powerful sound. The same thing that was recounted by those who heard him live, although it is a matter of debate amongst those who did hear him live if his recordings matched what he was able to do in concert. Regardless, it's all we've got, and they do show off what he did quite well. They give us the briefest and most tantalizing of glimpses into a world of violinist wizardry that was cut so very short.